We were talking earlier about how this particular project got its gestation, and the thing that struck me as different, among some of the other things about the film that are different, is that it was a relatively short process from concept to funding to let's get this thing done. And so could you elaborate on that a little bit?
Well, we started thinking about the idea for this film. I've worked for Morgan Neville, the director of this film, for about 7 years, about 6 years at the time. We had just finished, we were in the middle of working on our previous film called The Music of Strangers, which is a documentary about Yo-Yo Ma. And during the process of making that film and getting to know Yo-Yo, Morgan had asked him a couple questions, one of which was, how did you learn to deal with celebrity? And he said, Mr. Rogers taught me. And that was kind of the first seed of wanting to know more about Mr. Rogers, because he turned out to be a lifelong mentor to Yo-Yo Ma. He was a musician, and he was a person that just really guided him in his career and was a real mentor. So his name kept coming up, and we just kept researching him a little bit more. Morgan went on a deep dive into YouTube videos one night of Fred Rogers giving commencement speeches, and he thought, this is a voice that I want to hear more of in our culture today. I don't hear many adult voices anymore. And so pretty soon, that was about a six-month process of just thinking about it, and then one day, Yo-Yo Ma's son, Nicholas, said, Morgan, if you keep talking about Fred Rogers, we're going to have to make this movie. And because Nicholas had stayed lifelong or family friends with the Rogers family, he introduced us to the people at the Fred Rogers company and his family, and we got permission to do the film. And basically from there, we thought it might be a 2-year process to get to the end. But once we started telling people we were making this movie, they wanted it immediately. And it just turned out we started trying to fundraise for it, and people were very keen to get the movie made. And so it all went a lot faster than we expected. And basically right before the 2016 election, we started talking about it publicly and fundraising for it. And I think at that point in time, everyone wanted more Mr. Rogers in their life. So it went really fast from there.
Yeah, because I said that's kind of an antithesis of how documentaries usually work. I mean, they get talked about for years, and of course the funding goes through all sorts of permutations. And so so maybe that's just kind of another way to look at how this particular film needs to be looked at and examined, that things just kind of seem to fall into the right place to make it happen. And I mean, first of all, the footage that's available is absolutely fascinating. And something that I was asking earlier is, when you're putting a film together like this and someone is telling this great story on camera, does it sometimes involve someone telling this great story, then Neville or someone to you saying, can we find the footage to back this up? Or was it the opposite side where, you know, you or someone else is looking at footage and this is great, wonderful piece of film, and asking, can someone talk about that? How does that work out in both contexts?
Yeah, I think it happens both ways. I think going into this film, we had an idea of kind of what we knew of Fred Rogers, but we really started it with more of a curiosity of figuring out, who was this guy really? Is he really who we think he is, or who he seems to be on TV? And I think through the process of just interviewing friends and family and reading all the letters he wrote and reading all the communication to him, his speeches, starting to get into the archive of material we had at our fingertips, you know, we started to get to know who he was more. And when people would say something that surprised us, then we would kind of go look into that a little bit more. And sometimes we would find videos or things that we didn't know this event might have happened, and we would go ask people we were interviewing about it, and it builds from there.
And so where did all that wonderful footage come from?
Couple places. Since his show was on the air for over 50 years, there was over 900 episodes of the edited show. So we basically just started by asking them for every episode of the show. And our heroic assistant editor got to be the one to watch every episode and kind of mark it for what we were kind of looking for. And then beyond that, I mean, more importantly, was everything in between the edited episodes. It was all the behind the scenes material. In the show especially, there was a segment called Picture Picture, which you might remember. There was a picture on the wall, and when Mr. Rogers would go to it, it would show a little mini documentary almost of something that would be a learning experience for the kids, like going to the crayon factory. So he had a lot of little mini documentaries within the show that there was, they were all shot on film in like the 60s and 70s, and we would find those original reels of film and digitize them. So there was the archive of the show and all the behind the scenes things, and then there was also a research archive that called the Fred Rogers Center that had been created before he died, but it was his place to go and do his writing, and it basically housed all his personal papers and ephemera from the show, and it has a full-time archivist. It was thousands and thousands of letters, every letter every child ever wrote to him, plus his reply back to them, which he answered every letter. And with, you know, in boxes by the year, in order of subject matter, you know, divorce, grandma died, pet died, I'm sad, you know, whatever. They had a really good system. It just felt like, to a certain degree, they were just waiting for someone like us to come and kind of go through that and utilize it somehow. And then there was other things. There was, like, you know, commencement speeches he did. There was just interviews with the family and friends, all the people that were on the show, and that's kind of how we put it all together.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And it does appear that everyone was anxious to talk to Morgan about Fred Rogers. Were there any surprises among all the interviews that you can recall, or was there someone who just didn't want to talk, couldn't talk for some reason?
I think one of the favorite surprises for all of us was, you'll meet him in the film, his name is Nicky Tallow. He was the floor manager of the show for like 40 years. He was this really unexpected, like punk rock looking guy, tattoos up his arms and just kind of scruffy, and he like had a really kind of off-color sense of humor. You know, he wasn't the type of guy you would think would work for such a square show. But that's the one thing we found by talking to everyone who was on the show, is it was kind of a playground for all these different types of people. And Fred was not as square as everyone would think. He had a really funny sense of humor. And while he wouldn't kind of make the same kind of jokes as these other guys, he also kind of would chuckle once in a while when they made a funny one. You know, and it was kind of like a very, very immersive, loving and kind of friendly environment that it seemed like very unexpected characters were all in it together there. It was, yeah, and he is really funny in the film, so you're going to love him.
Mm-hmm. I know that it doesn't come up in the film very much from what I observed, but we know that Fred had he did have something of a sense of humor about some of his own celebrity. I mean, there were various parodies that were done of him over the years, and some, you know, a little bit more tasteful in his, in his mind than others. But how did he deal with his own, you know, sense of celebrity? You were talking about, help being a mentor to Yo-Yo Ma. Mm-hmm. Who helped Fred?
Well, I think he was just so driven on his mission, which was to be a voice that was there for all these generations of kids, that every time he would see, you know, and he kind of, I don't think he liked celebrity at all. He didn't like being recognized when he went out. He was a shy guy, but he knew that was part of his mission. And actually, he wasn't just a TV celebrity. He was actually a minister. And that's it was his mandate, and it was his way of communicating with the people he was ministering to, was through the television. And so when he saw kids in public and they had a connection with him. He tried really hard on the show to make a one-on-one connection with children, the way he looked through the camera. And I think he felt like he had to honor that relationship. Whenever he saw a kid in public that would run up to him, he would stoop down to their level and ask them questions and make them feel like they were really important and that whatever they had to say to him really mattered. And so that was just an extension of what he was doing with his show. I think when he went out into the world, he had to deal with celebrity that way.
Do we need to explain to a modern audience who Fred Rogers is? I mean, people of a certain age, you know, may have some first or second degree contact with him, either growing up with the shows ourselves or having our kids grow up with the, you know, with the shows. But now, you know, are we far enough removed now where we have to, you know, kind of explain what, you know, what the guy was about and what his appeal was?
Well, I think we do, because I think even with us and when we first started, and almost everyone who knows who Mr. Rogers is, I think they think he's that square guy who wears the cardigan and he's pretty simple and maybe, you know, it's for kids. I don't think we really knew, even before we began the film, of the depth of the mission of what he was trying to do and how that we, not only as children but adults now, have to apply that to our life and our communities and our neighborhoods. And, you know, I think his goal was that everyone walks out and is loving and friendly to their neighbor and, you know, inclusive in their giving to others and things. And I think there's no better time for that. And I think we were really surprised at everything we learned about him made him more deeper and complex and more of a full-rounded person with a lot of depth that I don't think many people quite know about. And so that's what we hope people, you know, realize about him when they watch the film and kind of apply some of what he did maybe to their own life as they walk out of the theater.
Okay. And one thing that I really enjoyed in watching the film very early on, there's that terrific scene where Rogers is testifying before the Congressional Committee to talk about why PBS funding needed to be. The show is only a year old. PBS is practically brand new itself, and suddenly it's immediately under threat. And I think it was just beautiful that footage was there and that it's included, because you kind of get the idea that even from that early stage, you know, the guy was charming. And he was able to persuade, you know, hardened politicians that, yeah, maybe this is something we could, we could afford to do. Mm-hmm. And in some way, you know, through the children, he basically just kept on, you know, selling the idea of kindness and goodness and compassion and equality and all those other wonderful, you know, all those wonderful things that you can't. You can't package, you can't sell. And in several spots in the film, there is the comparison made between, you know, what was on television for kids at the time. Mm-hmm. And he was definitely not a fan of, what was passing for children's program. And he took some, I was surprised he took some serious issues mm-hmm. with some of the stuff that was going on.
Yeah.
You know, it seemed like that, and he found a way to express his, I don't want to call it disdain, but his disapproval mm-hmm. of where he saw some things were going and how he wanted to offer an alternative.
Yep. Well, a lot of things came together right when he was setting out in his early career. At first, he had thought he would be a musician, and then his last year of college, television was basically invented, and he saw kind of ways that it was being used that he really didn't like and disapproved of. He thought the messaging was just so wrong for, you know, what people were getting through that television at them in their living rooms. And he changed his whole course of his career, and he decided to study television and learn how to produce it. At the same time, he was also learning, going through ministry. And at the same time, PBS was being born. And basically, it was the perfect platform for him, because his show wasn't really a big, no one really thought it was going to make a ton of money or be a big seller. And for him, that wasn't what was important. It was just that he had that outlet to reach millions of children in their living room and to be an alternative voice for what else was being programmed and thrown at them every day. And he really realized early on the power of television, like very few people did, and he learned how to kind of harness it and use it to do good. And he often said when he got older, they were very surprised at the success of the show and just how much it was embraced by not only kids, but obviously their parents and families. And a lot of the people who wrote thank you letters to Mr. Rogers wasn't really just the kids, it was the parents who actually got as much support and guidance through the show as the children did, and they were always very grateful. But he often said he would never have succeeded, or the show never would have succeeded if it were to come out today, probably just because of all the variety of options and how fast and kind of overstimulating it all is today. It was a very different time, but somehow it worked. And the other thing he said that I think is really important is that, and my argument for, you know, even today, try out watching some of those old shows with your kids, because what he would always say was that, you know, while media changes and the world has changed and technology's changed and all that, the insides of kids haven't changed. And if you sit them down and let them have, you know, a crazy thing on TV, or you sit them down and have a quiet, comforting, softer thing on TV, you know, they might just embrace that quieter time, just like they did in the 1960s and 70s.
And I guess one last question I want to ask is, what's the work being done with Fred Rogers Institute, the Fred Rogers Center? What are they doing to carry on his original mission?
Well, after he died, they had debated on what they were going to do with the show. Is there a way we can replace Fred in Mr. Rogers' neighborhood? And of course, that was absolutely impossible. You can't really do it. But what they did do was they took eventually, so they still have the Fred Rogers Company, and they still produce children's programming in Pittsburgh. They took the Daniel Tiger puppet character, and they gave him an animated show of his own, a spinoff called Daniel Tiger's Neighborhood, which is one of the number one children's shows today. And then the research archive still lives outside of Pittsburgh in Latrobe, which was his hometown. And it's a place where a lot of students go, like people who are studying PhDs in child development or writing books, and just mostly for students and educators to study his work. One of the directors, the co-directors of the Fred Rogers Center, actually just recently took a job at Harvard as a professor teaching a class based on the teachings of Fred Rogers. So we're hoping that his message will still kind of seep out there into the world through both the film and the work they continue to do.
And as I say, I think that's probably where we're going to have to leave it if we want to get the documentary in its entirety. And so, Caryn, I want to thank you very, very much for coming out.
Thanks.
And giving us a little bit of background and maybe a little bit of whetting our appetite for the documentary.
Enjoy the film, everybody.
And so we're going to go ahead and we're going to drop the lights and get the screening going in just a moment. So be patient.